This is the OMFL.
You can't touch this.
And you're in the mix with Kinda Romaine. Here's another OMFL production.
Good morning and welcome to Press Pass Live, your weekly OMFL podcast show. It's so good to have you in here. We're number 162 already. I can't believe it. We're going to jump right into it. Let me welcome in my co-host for the day, Mr. Bloop of the TFL. Mr. Bloop, how you doing today, buddy?
Good, man. There's like 5 feet of snow on the ground, so I'm just happy to be inside and waking up. And
that's a real thing? Up.
Yeah, it probably snowed another, probably at least a foot in the last week, so spring is slow up here in Canada.
Bro, it's like 90 outside down here. I can't even imagine. I wish it was still cold, but no, it is. It is like 90 degrees. We are sorry for the delay this morning. I am in the process of working on a couple new streaming sites to help us a little bit. And maybe make this a little bit better. And so playing with some ideas, but the one this morning didn't work. We're going to jump right into it with some fire drill time. We're going to talk about our favorite game from the last couple of weeks. And I think we got yours highlighted. So what's your favorite game?
Mine's
Colts Jets.
Cardinals Bengals.
Oh.
Same week. I haven't actually been able to watch a good competitive game for a while, so I watched this one last night. And I'm just saying that because every game I watch has turned into like a two-score game by the end. They've been good, but I watched this one last night, tuned in. I think it was 21-10 for the Cardinals when I started watching. The Bengals, immediately as soon as I got in there, started scoring points. They got themselves back into it. They nearly tied it up at the end of the game, wound up missing a 2-point conversion or something like that, at one point, and then the Cardinals scored a field goal to go up by 4. It was just a good game. Overall, you see the Cardinals had 130 rushing yards. You could tell that was kind of like their game plan was to rush the ball, especially in the second half. The Bengals, 286 total pass yards, but, you know, Colt, he was actually off on that game, Ryan Colt, MVP contention, kind of cute quarterback, but he missed a couple easy throws.
He's a cute quarterback?
Sorry, what was that?
you said cute quarterback.
No, sorry, it's early. I think I meant to say MVP it is caliber early. Quarterback.
Don't worry, Soden isn't here, and Soden made a perfect "that's what she said" joke, and I had to swallow it. So, and that's what she said too.
Well, he's kind of a cute quarterback. He has the exact same avatar as my quarterback. So
nice. Okay.
But yeah, his quarterback, he plays so well for the most part, but he missed a couple throws to, like, DeAndre Hopkins on the outside. His fullback dropped one, kind of, and then there's a couple other plays that just kind of let the Bengals down and wound up allowing the Cardinals to win. But it was a competitive game, as you can see, the score 30-26. There's not crazy pass rush. The turnover battle wound up being the difference, as since he said on his stream, he had two turnovers, including a kind of a bad fumble by Colt, and the Cardinals had none. So it was just a good all-around game. I thought both teams played to a high level, and it just came down to little things, a couple turnovers, and then, like I say, those misplays were the big difference. Both teams were really good to watch.
Total side conversation, but have the Bengals not put together the scariest set of receiving core ever? You got DJ Moore, DeAndre Hopkins, Travis Kelce, John Ross, Dalvin Cook coming out of the backfield, that's a scary set of pass catchers that are back there.
Yeah, it is.
So,
and they got Jack Doyle as well.
Yeah, it's just crazy. I'm going to go with the Colts and Jets, 48-41. You can see that the Colts were a lot of scoring in the fourth quarter of this game. 31 of the, 89 points were scored in just the fourth quarter. Of course, it's not a surprise what goes well in this game. 303. This game is so broke. Oh, God, we're going to talk about it in just a little bit, but this game is so broke. 303 rushing yards for the Indianapolis Colts, 73 passing yards for the Jets. Only one turnover for both of these teams, which was nice to see. And time of possession was pretty close as well. Just kind of breaking it down with some stats. Cam Newton still playing at a really high level. 271 passing yards, two touchdowns, no interceptions. Ken Green, the rookie quarterback out of LSU, who is playing much better, especially in this game, than I expected. 386 passing yards, four touchdowns, one interception. The guy was just kind of on fire with a 128 QBR. Tremont Smith, 16 for 148 yards. Who the hell is Tremont Smith? Like, seriously, like, how? I don't know how he does it. Looking at some receiving yards, Robbie Anderson kind of went off, 9 catches, 153 yards. Tobias Scott, who we know is the big play guy for the Colts, 3 for 109. And then looking at a couple of defensive stacks, Kenny Moore was kind of all over the field for the Indianapolis Colts. Ledbetter making a couple of plays there with a sack. Chris Jones had a sack. And the one INT came from Rock Ya-Sin, the best freaking name in all of football. But the Colts somehow escape with another victory. And this is kind of his gimmick the last couple of years, where all of a sudden he plays no defense and has an unstoppable offense and puts up tons of points and just squeaks out wins. And that seems to be the tendency of a lot of these games, which we are still trying to figure out, but we're going to get there. I had an interesting idea for this next section. It's called New Leaders. I want to show a couple of weird stats here as we run through, and it's probably even updated from last night's game, which was before I did this. But you got the Bengals leading the AFC North. You got the Titans leading the AFC South. You got the Patriots, your Patriots, 5-0, leading the AFC East. You got the Kansas City Chiefs leading the AFC West. You got the Vikings leading the NFC North. You got the Panthers leading the NFC South. You got the Giants leading the NFC East. And you got the Cardinals leading the NFC West. These are all fairly new leaders. Now, that doesn't mean that these players haven't won here, but we haven't seen them winning or at least leading their divisions in a very long time. Is this the new age, a new dawn, a new crop of leaders here in the OMFL? Will we see a little bit of a distribution of power, or is this just check in mid-season and let's see what happens by the end?
I would say this is definitely a kind of a new group of leaders. I think the big thing that, I don't think all these guys are going to every year to year be teams that win their division suddenly. But I think the big thing right now is after that the Devo program you guys set up and worked on, you're seeing it actually pay off, where teams are kind of more on a balanced playing field I think I've been on record in the past saying that the Madden version of their Devo program kind of favored the rich.
Yeah.
So I think what you guys did has really helped out as far as that goes. Then also at the same time, you're seeing teams kind of just, like my team, for example, I was really aggressive, completely changed my team, and it worked out. I'll say for the Vikings, they have a new owner. He had a new vision for that team, and it's completely kind of taken the NFC North by storm. The Giants, they've been just slowly building pretty much the entire cycle. I think the other three teams all took turns winning the division, and the Giants were in last place, and now they've hit a certain point. He made some trades last year in the offseason to improve his team, and now he's primed, ready to go. And then you also see, like, in the AFC West, like, Dwight Council and his offense are just going completely off. You know, I just think it's kind of a culmination of the Devo program helping out, and also just a lot of guys who have been building towards something all hitting it at the same time. Whereas the guys that were dominating for so long are kind of hitting some cap problems. They're hitting some, especially with the way prospects work now, like they're not getting the same level of talent late in the first round and stuff. Unless people are trading really good players to them. Like you see them, the top teams acquiring picks, but that doesn't necessarily mean anything anymore. So I think it's just a good culmination of all those kinds of things. I think this season we're going to see a lot of new playoff teams, and then we'll have to see going forward.
Yeah, I think I've seen glimpses of this in the past. Like, I do think the new Devo program has worked. I think also something has changed pretty dramatically in the game that no one can quite put their finger on, and it is definitely favoring a different type of player. You're seeing teams like the Titans and the Chiefs and the Vikings and, you know, the Cardinals put up a lot of points when these are teams that maybe struggled with offense, some of them in the past. And so something has shifted. Something has kind of really changed, and can't quite put our finger on it. Right. And hey, what's up, Dan Threx? Good to see you, buddy. I also think, like, we've seen glimpses of, if you just like take a snapshot in the early portion of the season when weird stuff happens, that you'll sometimes see this type of thing happen where it's actually not a good indicator of what's going to happen as we progress all the way through, and it's just kind of a snapshot early on. What will be interesting to me is, can the Giants, can the your Patriots, can the Chiefs, can the Cardinals, right? Can the Redskins, can these teams keep this up over 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 games into the season and still be one of the top leading teams at the very end? Because that's where it really shows. When we kind of hit this midpoint here, that's where the Seahawks and the Colts and, you know, the Falcons and those types of teams begin to really raise their game up. And that's where they just stay very, very consistent, where some of us struggle with being consistent in those moments. So I don't necessarily know that it's a set of new leaders, but my fingers are crossed that it is, because we needed a power shift in the OMFL. It was tired of, you know, it's been four or five bowls in a row of the, I think it's been four. It's been three, because I think the Miners were in the first one, so
yeah, I think it's
three,
like,
bowls in a row.
Five out of six.
Yeah,
two.
Yeah, five. That's what it's been, right? It's been the Colts, Falcons, and the Falcons have won, I don't know, five in a row now or six in a row, something crazy. And so, we needed a power shift. It's not good for the league to have somebody just completely dominate the way the Falcons have, and even the Colts in the AFC, and really the Falcons over the last three Maddens, because Dwayne had the Falcons before that and was winning a lot of bowls here. And so I hope for a power shift, but I'm holding out because I still have some wonders of, can they stay long? Do they have the longevity to keep this up throughout the rest of the season? Speaking of one of those new teams and the teams that, look, have been a winner here before, but that's the Cincinnati Bengals. Now, this guy has won here before. I don't know that he has a bowl win, but he's been in many bowls, and he's always been an offensive first guy. And Cincy Berg definitely has rebuilt this offense to be very, very powerful. And the key core of that is his quarterback, Ryan Colt. And this guy came out 2 years ago and was just a magnificent player. That is not who I want to talk about. What am I doing? I don't know why I got on the Ryan Colt bandwagon. This is about Dwight Cancel and the Chiefs. Oh my gosh, I lost my mind there. The Chiefs Ryan have Colt's won here before. Too, Ryan Colt is very good. Yes, I think it's because I got off track thinking about like when I just didn't realize that offense, those receivers that the Bengals have put together. So my bad, Massimo. This is about your guy. Massimo has had up and down seasons here, but been when he was Dallas, he was one of the more powerful teams in the NFC. Since taking over the Kansas City Chiefs, he's always had an explosive offense, but he's had this weird, it's like a love-hate relationship with the Chiefs, where he actually like shipped off all, like first he was going to hold on to all of them and just have a dominant offense, and then he canned it and like shipped off everybody, and has really rebuilt around this guy named Dwight Cancel, who ultimately wasn't even the best. He came out of the same draft as Colt, but wasn't even the best, you know, quarterback on paper. But Massimo has really put in the time. And listen to this guy's stats so far. 2,045 passing yards. He's 111 out of 168 for 66%. 20 touchdowns already. Only 4 interceptions for a QBR of 137.5. He has got a 12.2 yards per attempt. He has given up 16 sacks, but he's a little bit mobile in the back. But I want to talk about Dwight Cancel. Is this the new captain of the OMFL? Is this the quarterback that the OMFL is not going to look at as being that key leader here? And can the Kansas City Chiefs win with this type of like gunslinger offense?
Yeah, what the Chiefs have done with Dwight Cancel has been amazing, especially considering he came from the Packers. Couple seasons ago, like the Packers drafted him and didn't use him when Aaron Rodgers was there, so Massimo picked him up, and he's been pretty good ever since, and this year especially. But you know, actually, I want to go back to the guy you just mentioned before that, Ryan Colt. I still think Ryan Colt's the kind of the leader in the clubhouse for the young quarterbacks. The only reason I say that is I think Dwight Cancel is being carried by his receiver Tyreek Hill a little bit. He has 1,200 of his 2,000 yards so far and 15 touchdowns. So, I mean, Dwight Cancel is still an amazing quarterback. He has, I think, probably the strongest arm of any drafted quarterback in the league. So that's a huge thing. You know, he can rip it down the field. Obviously, he's playing at a high level, but I just feel like When you compare him to some of the other quarterbacks, the guys like Ryan Colt, Hunter Woodyard, even the Worthington from the Packers now, I just think, you know, he's maybe just a tier below the top. I'd say at least below Ryan Colt, but he's really good, and that offense I think is gonna keep going. And as the game's playing right now, I do think his offense is something that will hold up. The only thing is, like, I've seen a couple of teams be able to slow down Tyreek Hill, and if that happens, like, he has good weapons, but he has to be able to move the ball to more than just Tyreek Hill. He's 1,200 of the yards, so combined 800 yards for everyone else so far. I just want to see if he can do that against one of the defenses like that can actually shut him down. But so far, Council's been really good. Him and Tyreek Hill seem to have a good, like, that special kind of like Ben Roethlisberger and Antonio Brown relationship where they're, you know, able to just do whatever they want on the field. So yeah, it's been fun to watch, but it's also like it's actually, I don't know, it's just kind of scary to know that they can do what they're doing so far.
Yeah, I'm actually right with you. I think he is putting up magnificent stats, having by far one of the best seasons that we've ever seen in the OMFL from any quarterback. Look, 20 touchdowns and 4 interceptions, I don't care who you are, that's impressive. That's a pretty good job there by Massimo and this quarterback. I look, he's only 73 overall, which makes this even more impressive. But when you look at Tyreek Hill having 49 of the 111 attempts, I mean, that's it's almost half, right, of his attempts, or catches, I should say, not attempts, are going straight to Tyreek Hill. Tyreek Hill is going to probably break and shatter receiving records that that were, you know, put up by Colin a couple of seasons ago or a couple of Maddens ago now. I just don't know that you can win like that, especially as you get closer to the end of the season, especially as you start to play the better teams, especially as he moves into the playoffs and plays some of these really good defensive-minded teams. They just know they have one weapon to slow down, and now what are you going to do? And can Dwight cancel, spread the ball to some of the other targets? I do think that there are some better quarterbacks. Like, your guy is playing superb right now. We talked about Ryan Colt, who we know is a really, really good young quarterback. And I think even this draft, you're going to see, like, 4 or 5 quarterbacks come out. Like, this is going to be, yeah, this is going to be the Madden where everyone has all kinds of new quarterbacks, because there's just going to be just this whole new crop coming in with this next draft class that's coming in. So I'm buying into the Dwight Council hype that he's having a great season and may have the greatest season, you know, regular season ever here. I'm not buying into that you can win with him and win with this style of offense. And I'm not buying in that Dwight is the best young, up-and-coming receiver that we have here in the OMFL. All right, it kind of brings me to my last little bit of a rant. Madden 20, what have they done to this game? I still firmly stand by the game that I touched and played in July and in August was one of the best games I'd ever touched. The movement 2.0, the player reactions, the feel of the run game, defense was hard and would make teams pay for mistakes. And I got the concept that we will continue to do small live updates, you know, every other week. But I think ultimately, this game feels completely different, and I have not been a big supporter that, you know, some guys were like every update felt totally different. I didn't think it did. I think there were minor tweaks, and I'm having a hard time figuring out if this last update completely changed everything or if it's just been like a bunch of minor things that have been done over the last several months. This game feels to me completely broken, completely different. I can't figure it out. Yes, the whole concept of players just standing there as balls fly over their head and not playing the ball have always kind of been here, but that seems to be hyper now. Sack numbers are still crazy, even after we've made several tweaks and changes and even taken some ideas that you've given from the TFL. I just can't quite put my finger on it. And you play in several different leagues. Of course, your league, the TFL, you play here. What is your vibe about Madden 20? What has changed? What's different? Because I can't quite put my finger on it.
Yeah. I don't even know where to start. I completely feel the same way as far as, you know, I don't know where to even look to begin things. Like, TFL's issues are completely different than OMFL's issues. Like you say about those DB things where they just stand there. I've noticed, like, they fixed it at one point, and then, like,
yeah,
a couple updates later, it was back, and now it's worse than ever. Like, you see it all the time now. I've unfortunately been, like, I've probably, like, benefited from it a couple times, actually, but... that's not here nor there. It's just weird. Like, I was actually talking to Rob yesterday about TFL's statistics, and like, because our league completely feels like ridiculous too, but it's like completely different. Where like, it feels like the defense is dominating in our league, but then you look at every stat and we're like exactly where we want to be. Like, we'll be lucky, like, not lucky, but like, by the end of our season, we'll have maybe one guy at 35 sacked, which is pretty good considering where we've been. You know, tackles aren't crazy. Interceptions, we have no one over 10, and we're in week 14 there. Or 13 there, I guess. I just see Soden says he's playing without abilities. I think we're going to do that next year. But, yeah, in OMFL, as far as OMFL goes, like, the things I noticed is, like, and it's completely different than TFL, which is, like, I saw on your notes, like, you're considering All Madden, but it's, like, a completely different game on All Madden. In OMFL here, I've noticed, like, you throw the ball and your defender slows down instead of pursuing the guy at full speed. He, like, stops running at times, so then you get lots of yards after catch. You know, the DB bug, zone coverage is just, I don't even know. Unless someone throws, like, directly at your players, they don't cover really in zone coverage. Once in a while, they'll, like, you know, say you got, like, two guys running together, they'll defend it. But other than that, like, over the middle, there's not much defense going on. You know, some teams have crazy pass rush, but for, like, some of the other teams, I don't see a whole lot of pass rush either. Outside of getting sacks, but, like, there's no, like, pressure. In the pocket or anything, like, there's lots of time if there's no immediate sack. It's just weird to me. Like I say, I have no idea what we could possibly do. I looked at your sliders, they all seem to make sense. Like, I just don't get it. I think, and, you know, I'm not a big proponent that every update was bad either, but I think at the last, there's two that were, like, within a week of each other, and those two, whatever the combination was, they were really quick, yeah, and they just didn't quite seem to mesh with what was going on before that, and we got what we got now. Yeah, it's just a weird situation, like,
yeah.
I don't know. Especially, to me, the thing that bugs me the most is, like, the defenders who just slow down, you know, instead of pursuing quickly. That's just,
it's like that animation kicks in and it's just stupid.
Yeah, it just bugs me, like, because in OMFL at least we got a big, like, points problem right now. That's, we're, like, averaging probably at least per team another touchdown a game, probably a touchdown in a bit than previous seasons. And it's just, when you got guys not pursuing, that's exactly what you're gonna get. And it's, so far this season, you've seen way more guys scoring, like, 40 to 50 points a game than we have in the past.
Yeah, Soden said some really good stuff just around, like, you know, we know that EA does cater to the masses. I think that's been the problem, right? That was, my hope was when they had, like, competitive sim and arcade, that those modes would allow them to cater the game to the different audiences, and that sim would be for us, and that they would leave us alone, and that hasn't been, it just hasn't been the thing, and it hasn't been what we've seen. And I played around, I got this close from turning off abilities. What caused me to not do it is, A, I do like the concept. I like that players can dominate and be different and can stand out on their own merit, that speed isn't the only determining factor for a receiver. You know, what, there's a zillion other things, right, for each different position that we could go through. I liked that the X factor and superstar abilities gave players that opportunity to stand out and be different. And then we put in, I say we, that's not fair, Penguins and Rob and a little bit of me put in a lot, probably close to hundreds of hours of work into our Devo program. And when it finally got to a place where I was like, you know what, this is so much work, let's just turn it off. And Rob's like, let me try one more thing and let me make this work so we don't turn it off. And so that's what we did. And the Devo program worked. But it's funny, it's like, even though it worked in some ways, we've seen some weird things happen. Okay, here are some stats, okay? Number one, 15 teams are already in double-digit sacks, 20s and above, which is stupid. Like, doesn't even make sense. Can't even wrap my brain around that. 11 teams are averaging right at 30 points or above with 4 to 6 teams averaging 35 and above, or right at 35 and above. How does that happen? Like, nothing changed. We all of our sliders are almost at 50, except for a couple that we know need to be bumped. I am struggling with trying to figure it out. And now I feel like I'm stuck, because if I go and turn off abilities and X factors, which I'm totally cool with giving a try, and we may try for our last season, I'm throwing away like hundreds of hours of work that Penguins and Rob put into our Devo program, right? And so it almost makes all their work for nothing, right? We did it for one season. So it's a catch-22. I just know that even with X Factors and Superstars, Madden 20 in July and August was one of the best games I had ever touched, hands down, no questions asked. We begged them to leave it alone. This game at beta is the best game ever that I've touched. It ain't perfect, but leave it alone. And they didn't leave it alone. And something has happened there, right? Like, we've seen some of their people get off of, we've seen some people, some of their producers get off of Twitter. We've seen them, some of them leave. We've seen like new people there. It's just, I don't know what they do for Madden 20. What would it be, 2020? I don't even know. Madden 21? Yeah, Madden 21. I get all confused by the numbers. Madden 21. I don't even know where they go with it. I don't even know where they start. And I don't know. I just, it's a catch-22. And I think that even though we've put a lot of work into this Devo program, when we get to what we think is the last season, we may try to turn abilities off. I've never been a big all Madden guy. We were all Madden for a very long time because that really was the only way this game was playable. But I always felt like an all Madden, everyone played way above their ratings, and ratings didn't matter as much. Really, speed became king again. So I've tried to, I've tried to move them around a little bit. To where on all pro with heavily adjusted sliders, it felt like the right game. But something's changed, and we're definitely going to have to figure it out as a league. And I don't know that we figured out this season. And this season, it may be what it is for this season, unfortunately. But we're going to, I don't know, I'm open to suggestions, and we're going to keep, you know, fighting it and messing with it and seeing if we can't figure it out. Time to take some mailbag questions. So let's hop over to the mailbag and see if anybody has left us some terrible questions. Like, we always get some terrible. I think poor Denver is the only guy who gives really good questions. The rest are questionable at the least, to say the least. All right, let's hop over. This is probably one of the main reasons why I want to figure out a new system, because this PlayStation system of Safari sucks. I am not a fan. It's so slow and freaking gross. I don't know what it is. Oh, it moved me all the way to page 10. That's not what I want. All right, let me go back to page 9. It's also terrible, terrible streaming material, but we're going to get there. We're going to get it figured out here. Oh, all right, those are... That question from Denbrew about Little Koch being Joe Exotic, it was great. All right, Denbrew says, my question is about attributes that are most important to you at the cornerback position. Besides man and zone abilities, what are the next must-have abilities at corner? I think that's a good question. Look, you have to have, there's some positions you have to have speed. You have to be able to, guys have to be able to keep up with these fast receivers. And so I'm always looking at speed. I think in the last maybe Madden or two, I've turned my attention to even agility. How fast are they getting in and out of breaks? But I'm always going to be a man defense guy. And so I look at man defense first and foremost, and actually will sacrifice zone if I find a guy with really good man, some pretty good, decent speed. I definitely like play rec. I definitely have looked at hit power. Hit power is definitely pretty high on the list for me, especially this Madden. But when it comes to cornerbacks, Bloop, what are you looking at?
Well, for me, the coverage is definitely the top two, but third for me, especially this Madden where receivers are getting a lot of release, is press. You got to have at least, I think, 83 press on your starting cornerbacks if you're going to be able to play a lot of bump and run man coverage, which is kind of what lots of teams play recently. So that's one of the things I was identifying when I was looking for new cornerbacks this offseason, was guys that can press. I also like on a nickel guy, I like a guy that can tackle and pursue. So like my nickel corner is kind of like built like kind of a hybrid safety. He has 80 pursuit and I think only like 65 tackling, but that's not bad for a cornerback. And it just, if you're gonna have a nickel in the game and the other team runs, it's just nice to have a guy that can, you know, make those tackles for you. But for me, the biggest one is press. You see lots of cornerbacks without it just get burned, especially like I said, with the way the roles go now, you know, release is something that receivers get pretty easily.
I also think that size plays a little bit into it. I picked up a guy off of the Buffalo Bills practice squad because I lost Lattimore for the first 7 weeks or 6 weeks of the season, and picked up like this young kid. He's big. He's like 6'2". Bulky, you know, like 90, 91 speed, like 88 acceleration, but like mid 70s zone and man. He actually played really, really good in my game last week. And so I think size definitely has. What we've done now is we've just named off every other attribute that you could possibly name off of. But I think we got to the point. Little Koch says, what team is the biggest surprise and the biggest disappointment this season? I think for me, the biggest surprise is the Giants. Hands down, arguably the best team in the OMFL right now. Only 78 or 73 points given up on their defense. Sorry, I was reading. I can't read and talk at the same time. I'm goofy like that. He's only given up 73 points on defense this year. He's put up like 110 on offense. He seems to find that really good balance. Pepper is one of the guys that kind of put in that bucket of own worst enemy, as a lot of us are. And so the Giants, to me, are the biggest surprise. Biggest disappointment? That's a tough question. I don't know that I have... biggest disappointment, honestly, is my team right now. Started out 2-0. And then I don't know what happened. The wheels completely fell off, and I can't figure anything out. I can't run. I can't pass. I can't play defense. I had 6 sacks with my stud defensive lineman in week 1. He's had 2 since, and my team has like 3 over the last 5 games. I lost 2 of my starters on defense to injury for most of the season. I feel like I am the biggest disappointment that I have seen this, so far this season. What about you? Biggest surprise, biggest disappointment?
For me, the biggest, both of them are actually in the NFC North. The biggest surprise is the Vikings to me. I thought he was going to start off a lot. Like, I know he's a good player, and I played against him a lot in, like, TFL previously, and I know he was going to compete, but I didn't think he'd be 4-1 leading the division. You know, he wound up making some trades that really helped his team out. And it's going to continue to help his team out because he's a great runner with Ezekiel Elliott. That was a surprise to me. Number one, though, I would go Giants, but you are
makes way too many way too many adjustments. I mean, literally, he's making an adjustment every single play. He and I kind of had a moment where it wasn't him. I was just kind of frustrated, period, over a bunch of stuff. But definitely has some FPR that's got to get way cleaned up. We don't do anything every single play in this league, and he was making adjustments every single play, which kind of drove me insane. I've totally knocked you off of your comments. You were talking about the Giants.
Oh, I was gonna just say I would have picked the Giants too, but you dove into them. They've been really impressive. You know, I thought they were kind of going through the motions all Madden, but maybe this quarantine's helped Pepper, or I don't know what's going on, but he's motivated and he's playing well. He has Daniel Jones playing at a high level finally. So he'd be number one if I had to just be honest, but I just wanted to try another team. And then my disappointment would be the Detroit Lions. I think on the draft show, we all thought Cooley was going to be competing for that division. And I was bugging him yesterday because he's like, oh, I don't know why my quarterback's so struggling so much. Like, he's rated pretty good, better than my quarterback is even. But the thing is, like, he just didn't bring in another receiver. He needs someone other than Galladay and his tight end Hawkinson. So I think that's where their big struggles are coming from. But they got like an elite defense, that's allowed almost 190 points, like an elite rate defense. Anyways, good offensive line, good running back, but they're 1-5 and struggling right now. So I just that's just probably my biggest disappointment. Although in the NFC North, we seem to never really know what's going on, other than, you know, Smash says he's not going to win, and then he winds up like 10-5 or 10
ends up winning. Yeah. Speaking of our buddy Mr. Ross, he's got a buttload of questions here. He says, if you took over, you just took over a first year franchise, what position do you pick first ever, first overall, and why?
I know lots of people don't think this way, but I'm definitely like an actual NFL. I built my team like an actual NFL team, so I'm definitely going quarterback.
Yep.
If you can find the right quarterback, you know, things get easy. Like my first two seasons, I had Tom Brady.
Way easier.
Oh yeah, I had Tom Brady and 72 overall wide receivers. I didn't even start Julian Edelman because he was so slow. I just had Deion Kane, who was 72 overall. Like, I think N'Keal Harry back then was like 75 overall. I don't even remember my third receiver, and I was still like a 13-3 and a 12-4 team in those two seasons. So I think a quarterback is definitely where I go.
Yep, that's exactly where I'm going. I think it's a little bit of a loaded question because it depends on what your team looks like, but if you don't have a quarterback, you have to go quarterback. Everything completely changes for how you build your team and how much easier it becomes when you know that the quarterback position is not only set in stone, but is on a rookie contract for most of that Madden, which is another completely big maker in this Madden. If you don't have to pay a quarterback, then you're going to be really, really in a good shape. He says, using our current pool of players in the OMFR right now, who would you select as your number one overall pick? It's a good question. I'm still going to go quarterback. I would have to go dig at all the different you know, young rookie quarterbacks. I want a guy on a rookie deal if he's a stud. I think if I had to pick, I'm taking the Packers quarterback. I think he is a guy that you pick and stick on your team on a rookie deal, and you're set for forever. Like, that guy's a stud.
Yeah, that's a good pick. For me, it's more of a personal thing, but I take Keelan Pyle just to get him away from the Falcons.
Look, he's been a game changer, right? Keelan Pyle has been what the quarterback is for our offense. He's been for the Falcons' defense, where just everything seems much easier. And he literally is our Deion Sanders. He completely shuts down one side of the field, and he will be a Hall of Famer after this Madden. Number three, in our current state of Madden 20 right now, latest update in stupid gameplay, passing or running, offense or defense, which do you feel is most important? Balance is not an option.
For me, I'm definitely, I think passing is kind of like the great equalizer. I think it's important to be able to run the ball, but if you can't run the ball and you can pass it, you can stay in any game. Same thing on, like, for the second part, I guess. I'd stay pass game on both sides, offense and defense. Like, if you can stop the pass, it makes things a lot easier. Yeah, I just, you know, teams can run, like, I haven't had a whole lot of success in recent seasons, but, like, teams can run on me, running on me last season, and then I'd follow it up with, like, a 50-yard pass, and, you know, it really kind of levels things out pretty quick when you can do that.
Nope, I'm with you. I think I'm a passer at heart. I think I'm a receiver. That's what I played growing up, and so I want the ball. I want to pass the ball, and I've always felt that I was a pretty good passer until I played this Madden. But I am still a little old school in my heart, and I think if in Madden, if you have a running game that is unstoppable, it frustrates the defense to no end, because if they throw zone at you, if they throw man, if they blitz you, it opens up passing lanes. It's just, it can be really, really tough. So I would lean towards the running game as the most important, but it has to be really good and it has to be established, and you have to stay committed to it. And then I think on defense, you have to stop the run. If I'm forcing you to pass, even if you're a very good passer, chances are at least in my favor, you know, 70-30, that you're going to make a mistake and turn the ball over. And if I can get you to make some mistakes and then start chasing in the air, then more opportunities to make more mistakes. You know, an interception's much more likely than a fumble in this Madden. And so I definitely would lean towards stopping the run and establishing the run. And I know that's super, super old school, but that's the one I lean to. Let's talk about our partners and then let you put a bow on this whole show. Thank you so much for being with me. Lots of activity in the chat. I appreciate you guys. DaddyLeagues.com. If you have a Madden League, you should be supporting Daddy Leagues. You should have a Daddy Leagues website up and running. They're super cheap, and they are the central hub for all activity for your league. You can see our Daddy Leagues page here. It's something we put a lot of work into, something we take a lot of pride into. And something that is visited very often for our league. So DaddyLeagues.com, our buddy Poppy has just been a big supporter of us. We are a two-time Daddy Leagues League of the Year, and just really appreciate them. Matt over at League Crawler, LeagueCrawler.com. I'm a massive fan of Matt and his work. I believe that what he has created at LeagueCrawler.com is one of the most useful Madden, WWE, MLB websites out there. I think he hosts way more than Madden. It kind of started off as a Madden thing, but now he hosts way, way more. Matt is just a great guy, and it's a great place to go find owners, to rate leagues. If you're an owner looking for a league, to really find out what other people think about it. Now, of course, you're going to see a lot of, you know, bad comments, because that's what people do. They don't like to own their own stuff. Instead, it's that commissioner's fault. It's that league's fault. They cheat or whatever. But if you're here in the grown folks community, I, you know, really push you to go create a profile there. go rank the leagues that you play in and leave a comment about them. And of course, you see our buddies right here in the chat, Soden over at Soden Bowl. That is our Xbox One partners. Anytime we get owners who play Xbox or come to us looking for a good league in the Xbox community, we immediately send them over to Soden over at Soden Bowl. One of the most connected, engaging, cutting-edge leagues that you are ever going to see. They put a ton of time into their graphics and into their look and their feel and their engagement of their community. They're putting out really great content. If you're here, go support them. Give them a follow, a like, a subscribe. They're constantly doing play-by-play games and just really amazing graphics and all just kinds of super cool stuff that I wish I had more time to do. Unfortunately, I'm the only one who creates all of our stuff here, and there's only so much time that that one person has. And so they put a lot of energy and a lot of effort into what they're doing, and just really, really good dudes. And you can see our other partners here that, you know, are mainly our WWE guys, but we're going to talk about our last buddy, Shop, over at shopmaster.com. Now, I haven't talked to Shop in some time, so hopefully Shop is all well with the coronavirus. But Shop is just putting out amazing content for the 2K and Madden world. Now, I haven't seen his content in a bit, so again, I haven't seen him streaming, but I hope all is well. But anytime you want some 2K content, excuse me, or some Madden content, go follow him, give him a like and a subscribe, and check out his stuff. You're not going to be disappointed. Shop is super engaging and just a really good dude, and has been good to our community, and we appreciate him. And that's it for our partners. Of course, you can go check out our website, grownfolksoc.com. We would be honored to have a subscribe and a follow. I do most of our streaming, at least in this realm that you're viewing now, and currently I'm working with some new programs trying to see if there are better ways that we can continue to update what we do and just make it even better. But streaming a lot of PUBG, a lot of Warzone. We have a new baseball league that I'm streaming, and of course Madden, my podcast, this podcast, the All 22, which we haven't done in a while. We're going to try to get back to that next week. So just lots of stuff, our draft shows, lots of content, and if you want to dig into it. And I know that seems, it's mainly going to be for our community, and I get that, but if you're into watching different games, give us a like and a subscribe. And of course, we got to push the different leagues that we have here. We have 7 different Madden leagues here, and of course, one of the top ones is Mr. Bloop and the TFL. So, Bloop, put a bow on the show and tell people about the TFL, any openings that you have, or if people are interested, how they can get more information about the TFL.
Sure, yeah. We have, I guess we do have, well, technically 4 openings, although I think I filled 2, so 2 openings. The Saints and the Chiefs, I think, or maybe.
No love to my Saints, man. Those have been open a couple different times.
Yeah, and it's funny because they're like they're a good team, and even as just CPU, they're I think they're maybe 1 or 2 games back of the playoffs right now. So, yeah, I don't know why people don't like the Saints, but. What was I saying? So we got a couple of openings. You can get a hold of me at TFL_MaddenCFM on Twitter, or you can add me, one sec, I gotta find my name, on Discord, Bloop, hashtag 1489, and I can get you connected. Just to describe our league really quick for anyone that's listening, we're completely no switch. We got like a lot of play calling. No, I won't say play calling rules. We got lots of like post snap rules where like we limit what people can do as far as running goes and stuff like that. So there's quite a bit of rules to get used to. But once you get used to it, I think it's a really fun way to play Madden. So if you're interested, just get a hold of me, or I guess you can apply on the Grown Folks OC website, and we'll catch you there as well. So, yeah. And then, if I'm going to wrap it up, I just want to say I'm 5-0 in all NFL, and go Pats.
You are 5-0, but we'll see where you are in week 15, which will happen pretty soon. TFL, you can find all their rules and sliders and Daddy League's page, everything on our Join Us button. You can also just enter your name. It's a small application. Select that you want to be in the TFL, and just tell us why you want to be here, why you would be a good fit for our community, and that will email Bloop, and he'll connect you with our Discord. Look, I think that we're in a weird place as a Madden community. I think the game has changed dramatically. I'm not loving the FPR I'm seeing. I think last show I was by myself, and I bragged on the FPR. It was the highest rated FPR, and now I'm questioning, is that because people were just very, very lazy and didn't want to give real feedback because they didn't want the blowback from it? Or is the FPR just that bad this year? Because it has not been good. Guys are doing the same thing over and over and over. Cover one and cover three have completely taken over this league, and it's driving me insane. We are not supposed to be doing a majority of the time. You're to call your play and run your play, period. Yes, you're allowed to audible. Yes, you're allowed to make a hot route from time to time. Yes, you're allowed to flip the play or, you know, do you from time to time as strategy. But when you go to the line of scrimmage and you're making the same adjustments every single time, when you're making the same hot routes every single time, here's the three gimmicks I'm finding, right? I'm going to play cover one man, which puts the safety in the box, covering the running back. So even if I move the safety back manually with base align, he's going to come ripping and roaring at the running back. And so if the running back stays in, he becomes an extra blitzer. If the running back carries the ball, you've got an extra man in the box to stop the run. I'm going to bump and run cover you out of that so that you don't have time to get a quick pass off. And by the time your guy gets, the receiver gets off of my bump and run coverage, you're already sacked. The other gimmick I'm seeing is cover three, right? Cover three has kind of become the new cover two from last Madden, and it just puts another guy in the box playing short zone. We're going to, again, zone isn't as powerful, but if I can cover everything quick and short and bump and run cover you, then when you give time for guys to escape, I'm going to get the sack, which is why our sack numbers are so high. And here's the new gimmick I've seen is we get to the line of scrimmage, and I call number one, two tight end offenses have completely ruined this league, I think. I refuse to run them as a base offense. I know that we allow it, but I think all of you have caught on, mainly because of the Falcons, that two tight ends is going to establish the run and open up the pass game, and I think it's super lame, and I wish that I could change it and may change it if it doesn't change soon. Then guys will call overloaded offenses. Now, I know I was called out by the Falcons Seahawks by this because he felt like I did it a little too much, and I did it because he was playing a lot of man defense, and he had these, you know, superstar cornerbacks, and I was trying to figure out a way to move guys around and get some lanes open. But this is what I'm seeing is it's not the two-man or the overloaded offensive sets that bother me. It's people call overloaded sets. If you're in zone, I'm hot routing one of those for a deep route, and I'm going to hit that quick deep route. So instead of actually letting the deep route develop and go deep, I'm hitting them within the first 5 yards, even though they've been called on a streak because I'm giving them the ball really quick. Which is just another, like, manipulation of AI, manipulation of playbook, manipulation of what we're doing, and it's just, it's lame, and I think we can be better and do better. The concept of this league will always be that strategy and play calling and team building outweigh thumb clicking and AI manipulation because you know what adjustments need to be made before the other guy does, and you can quickly do those. It's why we had to freaking limit adjustments. It's all this stuff. I played one guy who literally slid his protection on every play, even run plays. So it didn't matter that the run play was called and designed to go one way. He's still going to slide protect, and it just manipulates the AI and changes all kinds of things, and just, it's not what we're supposed to be about. Run the plays that you call, use your adjustments when necessary, but most of the time we're supposed to be lining up and play the defense that was called against the offense that was called, you controlling your running back and quarterback and us controlling whatever defensive player we picked and let the best man win that play. That should be happening 50 to 60% of the game here in the OMFL. And it's just not happening right now. And this always happens. We get to this point in Madden, guys figure out what works, what doesn't work. Well, I can't build my team to fit what works, and so I'm going to make these adjustments to make this work better. And it's just, it is disappointing. And I've had some unenjoyable games lately as we figure out this new Madden and these updates and what we can and can't do. And I just think the guiding principle should be to run the plays that you called without a bunch of adjustments. There's a reason we make a bunch of adjustments. It's because you know they work and they give you an advantage and you had nothing to do with it. Slide protecting, you didn't do anything. You didn't build a team. You didn't call the right play. You're manipulating the AI to give you an advantage in that play. When you play cover one and bump and run coverage, it's not because you called a great defense or you built a great defense. It's because you're moving players around and manipulating the AI to give you the advantage on that play. Get the advantage because you called a better play and because you built a better team, not because you know what adjustments to make because you've seen something on YouTube or you learned something because you were testing. It's not what this league is supposed to be about. So I've ranted about FPR, and that's going to be my closing statements because I want to see us to do better. Later tonight, I'll do a Saints and Sinners. I'm going to try to get an all-22. You know, I got to get somebody to actually do one with me, but we'll do an all-22 hopefully next week. Press Pass Live is coming out here. I even do a hot seat maybe next week too. We haven't done a hot seat in a couple of weeks. So lots of new content coming out, lots of new content on the website. And then, of course, the Baseball League is fired up. Warzone is taken over. PUBG is still going strong. So lots of good, fun content. Bloop, thank you again so much for being with me, for the rest of the leadership here in the OMFL and the Grown Folks Online community. God bless you this week. Have a great week. We'll see you. Peace.